passing everything are created. Time is created. See? So everything in the universe is created except Allah, the Quran, such kinds of things. Why? The thing is that if you say a number system is zero to some, it's an open system. Okay? So zero, one, these are number systems. Why are they number systems? Okay? It is axiomatic, see, that you will not be able to count if you don't have these numbers. Okay? So they are given assumptions, axiomatic, the axioms of the numerical system. See? But the idea is like Weierstrass asked the question, can we deconstruct it and see what is interior to zero, to one, to another, especially the whole number system that is called the natural number system. Can we deconstruct it, like a brick being broken, okay? It's like a brick being broken into pieces, okay? That is the human inquiry, to go and find out what lies inside, okay? So, Quran asks you to do that, see? And thus, therefore, the beginning of the universe, that how the universe is given its meaning, its arguments, its existence, its shape, form, all of these kinds of things are because of a thing that exists by itself, that commands, that gives laws, okay? This initial thing is what we say is that you can't really explain zero and one, otherwise you will not be able to count. So if you don't understand, you don't accept, that initial existence that has created the universe, then you don't even understand the universe. See, according to the same kinds of arguments. Okay, this is the law of Allah, and it is that law of Allah that we want to study as Tawhid. See. Therefore, what the way that if we want to study the emanation, the coming about of a certain scientific worldview, Wilton Shum, okay, the great methodology, then our intention, my intention has never been to go into the metaphysical ideas of Tawhid, okay, because that is incomprehensible, okay. We can't reach out the iman of people. We can't reach out the meaning of sifat. We can't reach out into the meaning of al-qadr and all these kinds of things. So that is not within the study of the meta-science of Tawhid. All that we do is to accept Tawhid as law, okay? And it is the law that governs, okay? That gives shape and form to all the diversity of things that we encounter. See, this is the ontological law, okay? Hence, omega is that as if what I usually call is a super cardinal topology, which is a mathematical thing. That is to say, we can count this, all right? But it is relational, it creates, okay? So when things are created, then of course it gives empowerment to the universe. That empowerment of the universe comes in the form of shapes, forms, explanation, argumentation, abstractions and applications, okay? So the omega that you see right in the beginning, okay, this is the deep law of Tawhid, okay? And the law of Tawhid is embodied. It is in an open, unbounded space, okay? Because we cannot count, we can't configure that thing. We can only take that to create relations. That what this law, how is it make me act in certain things? Okay? In very many, all different things, in fact. Alright? So this is the law. And the law is of one thing only. The law of that is the law of Tawhid, meaning the law of oneness of God. And the universe, is the study of the universe, is simply nothing else, absolutely nothing, okay? Absolutely nothing but the study of the oneness of Allah, okay? This is the Tawhidi primer, okay? It is the first, okay, thing, and that is the first and the end, okay? So this is the law, and the law is essentially that thing, which is the law of the oneness of Allah, the unity And because Allah is full of knowledge, when we study the law of Allah as the oneness of Allah, then we really study the law of the unity of knowledge. Okay? So essentially, Omega as a workable thing, okay, that comes to me as an empowering thing, something that makes me act upon other things, okay? Make things, explain things, make models and explanations, abstractions, okay? Applications and extensions, okay? Continuities, okay? These are all made by the human being, taking advantage, taking stock of Tawhid as the law of the completeness, that is the oneness of Allah. That is to say, the human being, all that is there in the universe, takes that law. The human being as an animate being, as well as the inanimate beings, okay, like the trees, okay, which speak themselves, all the other kinds of things that speak themselves out, okay, they all take this law, okay, and expresses them. They all express that law in very many different things as an understanding of what we call is the unity of knowledge. Right? It is that unity of knowledge that we study. Okay? Now, the unity of knowledge is are at different levels. Okay? But the unity of knowledge here, which comes from the origin, that is the primal origin of Tawhid, which is Omega, the first one. Oh, where is it gone? This one. The very first one. The unity of knowledge. So Omega itself is a completeness. It expresses itself for our purposes of making a meta-science out of its implication. For our purposes, we are talking about it as the ontological, the primal law that exists, has existed by itself. It is a being, B-E-I-N-G. It's a being, it exists, it existed. And it creates, it is a non-configurate. You can't count it. You can't give it shape and form, okay? You can't give it certain kinds of things, like we say, you can only add apples to apples and pears to pears. You can't add apples to pears. No, nothing of those things are limitations within Omega. See? Omega is simply a relational completeness, which is God. It is non-configurate. You can't count, you can't shape it, you can't, you know, find it out, give it shape and form, all this kind of things. Okay? It only explains, gives us laws. Okay? And these laws are of the nature, the complete unity of knowledge, because Allah is one. Okay? The oneness of Allah is expressed not in terms of this, alright? Which is a shirk, alright? Allah is not this, alright? It's a completeness of knowledge, of ilm, that we say when Allah is absolute, perfect, is ikhlas. So when we say he is ikhlas. So that's the law that we are using, okay? And this law, it will show you at every nooks and corners of the universe, everything that you do, it will show you as one of its main essential property, okay? If you don't take that property, you are doing something else. You are not doing a Tawhidi world methodology, exercise, approach. Something else you are doing, okay? Now, that thing which you will find in everything to which the law of Allah, that is arising from the Quran and Sunnah, finished, all right? That's it, all right? Arising from Quran and Sunnah, this is the ontological law, not the ulama, okay? That comes later on, okay? This is the ontology, alright? And what will it show you? When you use this, ontology means the theory of existence, theory of being, original primacy of things, okay? when you use this, what will show? Okay, it will show itself, right? If it does not show itself, then it has no relevance, as I said last time as well. See, it has to show itself. And how does it show itself? It shows itself in the nitty-gritty of construction. See, if you are going to say that, well, is medical science really a science of this nature? All right, medicine makes people well, doctors make you well, right? So it should be a good thing, okay? As I said to you, what the words of Arabic, okay, Ibn al-Arabi, you see, is obfuscations. That is, anything that is foreign, if it enters your brain, your way of thinking, anything that is foreign outside the Tawhid, the way of looking at the world system, then you have created an interruption, you see, and it would be very difficult for you to disentangle yourself from that kind of invasion that comes. Okay, so the way to prove whether the medical science is complete, is it improvable? Can you improve that further on? Can it be of greater benefit to humankind? What should be required of it to become of that kind of a medicine, and all this kind of thing? To ask those questions, then of course they automatically enters there an obfuscation, that is to say, an interruption. Okay, as an example, and I have no ideas to really go on in this on this topic, but just to introduce you, just to show you that really how profound and singular that is, standing by itself, it is singular. Okay, there's no other competing things with this study, just to show you that fact. And then I asked a doctor once as well, and I usually converse with people, right? And I asked him, doctor, you have made great strides, the medicine has made great discoveries, strides forward to cure human beings. That's good, right? But I don't see that you have really integrated the body and soul. How do you treat the soul by the medicine that you have? You see, there is no answer to that. So, in other words, the world today, if you read, for instance, the American, Scientific American, okay, a very nice and well-informed journal, right? It's got a very, very high citation, around about 24, I think, right there, okay? So if you see that, the world has marched, the medicine world, the medical world, okay, has marched into rehabilitative medicines. See, rehabilitative medicine. These days, for instance, in Canada where I live, they don't give medicine so easily to children. Okay, let them cure themselves, all right? So the world is marching into rehabilitative, see, medicine. Like, for instance, I know many universities. In fact, I was reading the curriculum of the University of Edinburgh. Said illness and well-being or something like that. See, that's a course, that's a program, not a course, a program in sociology. All right, and it says really that illness is not. It's not body, see? Illness, you can't cure illness by bodily approach, see? What will you do with a mental patient? Okay, will you give him electricity? Okay? Electric shocks, that's a physical thing to do. Rather, they say, give him rehabilitation, all right? So the world is marching, the medicine world is marching more, increasingly more and more into a rehabilitative way of curing disease, illness, and bringing about wellness for people. You see, this is where the soul appears, but there has not been any great advance of the study of medicine as that. And just an example that I have given. Whereas in the Tawhidi world, you have to take those things into consideration. Because you are trying to explain the universe in all its great detail, as much as we can as human small entities in this universe, as a kind of a continuously, what you call, integrated, right, entity of body and soul. See, we are both human beings in body, but we are soul in our ethical, moral approach. Okay? So any choice that you are making, any construction that we are doing in the world, must keep this kind of consciousness. This is the Tawhidi worldview, and it is not a small one. Okay? I'll come down to that. Okay? So that is what the world is inside. Okay? That omega is transmitted. See? Allah is not one that who only lives in Istawa. He comes down to us, he is with us, right? But he is with us by his law, by his knowledge, not by anything else. Okay? So the law of Allah is that which transmits itself to us, okay, and enables us to create science, okay, things, okay, and etc. Right? And this transmission, there has to be something which transmits that law into the universe for the purpose of its construction, meaning and other kind of things, right? If there was no such thing, then we would become just like the people who want, blind people who wanted to study the elephant, you see? Then we would be like that, see? We would each have our own interpretation of the universe. There will not be any regimentation, no unity amongst our ways of thinking, okay? And hence the progress of the human race would be perpetually in a momentum of conflicts, you see? So well, that's not what we want, okay? So hence there is a transmission. This transmission is denoted by S, and that S is the Sunnah of the Prophet, okay? And that S itself is a Sunnah just like the Quran, you see? Just S is the Quran, you see? As you will see in many great well-thinking people, okay, have said that the Quranic meaning doesn't end. See, it's like a phenomenon. The Quranic meaning never ends. See, even today, when you, I know it's your experience that if you are reading the Quran with meaning, with understanding, and if you visit and revisit the same ayats once and many times over again, you will not be a still piece of stone, okay? You will be an ever-evolving thinking mind, right? So that is one of the great, what we call the, one of the great, what we call this, you know, is miracles of the Quran, you see? That it opens up the mind to an endless vista of knowledge, endless vista of knowledge, okay? This is the middle one, where we construct our world by integrity, by configuring things, by thinking about things, right? By applying those things to various different, to construct them, to make use of them, right? Use a fact, okay? And we make them, we keep on learning from our past to the future, right? So all of those things are embodied within. These have called these kinds of constructions. Once you have taken the law from the original primacy of the of Tawhid, which has been transmitted by S, and it's not on my plate, see, for our enjoyment, okay, for our use. The use of all of this thing is my utilization of that to construct. And that is the middle point. It's the world system. Okay? And this world system is then empowered. Okay? You can construct the world system in so many different ways. One of the way of doing is that, like science, like medicine, which I have given you, exemplified for you, the doctor treats the doctor treats a patient, right? But he makes no he makes no reference to Allah, to anything else, any law, but the law of men, but what medicine has taught you and how much he has specialized in himself in the medical field as a doctor, and he gives it not to save life. Doesn't care whether a life is saved or not saved. That's not his concern at all. Okay? His concern is the proof of what of his profession. See? That if he has saved a patient, then he has become successful in his profession. Are you following? Okay. This is the attitude. See? And it is not only for doctors. I don't want to denigrate them. I always have to visit doctors and take their medicine and so on and so forth. But the fact is, this is what science is about. Now, we keep on marching. Okay, the world that Allah has given us is for learning. Okay, we keep on marching. Okay, and every time we march, we construct, we accomplish certain things. We have gone over a series of processes of learning. These processes of learning are not haphazard. Okay? They have structures. Okay? And the three structures which I have tried to find out from the Quran, okay, is firstly the interactive structure, that you have to interact in order to ascertain that what you are thinking is correct or not correct, or is it improvable. Okay? Can it be improved? Can you be put in a more in the path of certainty, okay, a greater degree of accuracy? Okay? This is interaction. First one, the you, like that, the union. This interaction with whom, all right? And this is where two kinds of people come about, all right? And the first one, which if you read the verses of the Quran, you will find that if you have disputes, then refer it to Allah, to Prophet, and those in authority amongst you. See? And those who are in authority amongst you are the ulul amr, the ulul albab, those who know much on this, in this topic, right? But that's not alone, okay? Ulul albab, but the thing has to come to me. I am the end point of the end user. So as an end user, I am a participant. I want to find out whether what they are thinking about is acceptable to me. Is it good? Is it usable? Can I put my mind in it? My views? Right? This is what is called discourse. Okay? And the Quran has given that great discursive power of the Shura. Okay? A Shura is not anyway. What I'm meaning, Shura is discourse, discursive. Okay? So, in Ulul Amr and Nidran are important mushtaqs, okay? But still, you see, you can participate, we can participate, the world can participate with them. That's therefore, they do not have the final authority, see? They do not have. The Ulul Amr, they are helpers, okay? They will guide you, but they are not the ultimate. In the body of science, we cannot take that thing. And if you study, for instance, Muhammad Asad, okay? His book, Our Law, okay? Very small book, but it's what a wonderful book, okay? It's a book of the future, okay? Written past, okay? Some time back, right? And in that, he says, it brings out this very point. The most essential plane, the body, the origin, the primacy of knowledge is the Quran and Sunnah. See? And after that, it's a guidance, right? All the else, all other things are guidance. They help us, alright? But I'm in no way bound. So the Quranic verses say, if you read well, the subsequent ayat of the Quran after this is that if you have dispute, then refer it to Allah and the Prophet. See? So it is repeated twice. Okay, we just take the first one sometimes and ignore the second part. But the second part is essential, right? So therefore, those are the kinds of things that make us interact. Out of interaction, we cannot just go. Even the Robert's rule of law will not allow you that, all right? Even the Robert's rule of law says that you can't keep on talking and arguing and making an interrupting the meeting all the time. So he gives a ruling, okay? Stop that. Now ask the question, right? So also it's here. The fact is, the Quran says, interact, learn together, participate, to find out opportunities and alternatives. But please do stop somewhere, all right? This is integration, see? It is not ijma, not unanimity, okay? You don't have to go into unanimity, and the Sharia people will tell you better in this. You can come into workable agreement. See, it is the workable agreement that is necessary in order to function any decision. Otherwise, you will keep on talking, all right? And never reaching any agreement. See? This is integration. These two structures are structures not of institutions and markets alone. They're structures of things, of all things by themselves. They are structures. So when you talk about integration, then what is the equivalence of integration in the world of analytical science? Equilibrium. See? It's equilibrium. Alright? That the world, the Quran is talking about always, about equilibrium. But of course, in a scientific way of argument, you've got to understand what is the nature of this equilibrium that the Quran is talking about. Okay? That is the break. That is to go interior of matter and find out what is this nature, what is the nature of this equilibrium. Right? That is a scientific, what we call that? Inquiry, okay? Into deeper things. Right? So there is that interaction that leading you to integration and the two together. And then after that, this is the process. You have done this for one thing, to make up your shop, okay? You make up your shop and you keep all of these things in view, all right? Okay, physically, you remember all the enabling things of situating a shop. At the same time, you also take into account the ethical and moral things that need to be embodied in the construction, establishment, situation of a shop. Okay, so you've got both of them integrating together and coming about through this. This is a process, okay? And this process is what we call atemporal, okay? It is on a board, okay? This on the platform of a certain point in time or period of time, okay? So if you say a period of time, then of course you will say, how is my nation, national economy, doing over its 5-year planning period, see? So this 5-year planning period is as if you are period one. Are you following? Okay, so you take that to be the process. The process is the 5-year time period, okay? That is your process number one. You have learned, you have organized your economy, okay? You have evaluated the economy and you've got results, okay? You calculate the growth, you calculate the investment, the employment, the poverty, and all of that, different kinds of things, all right? Where do you go from there, all right? Then you come to the second 5-year development plan, okay? And in the second 5-year development plan, you would do the same thing, okay? But in between the two, the first and the second development plan, you have a learning process. Okay? You have a learning process. You know how it works. First, you do what we call, you measure the world as is. Okay? You got the data of the world from development plan, your experience, the number of employment and growth rate and all those things that have been given to you out of action. That is the action of what has been done as is. And the second process, when you go over to the second development plan, will give you the same. There also you will take up these inputs of statistical data and many, many other kinds of things, and will put, you will put inducing in that also your consciousness of ethical and moral values, and then you will have come to an evaluation of the world of the second development plan as is. Right? But in between the two, that is a learning process, okay? And that redefines the second, okay? And also the first, see how it happens. You see, when you have entered the first one and you have calculated the re-examination, okay? That is re-evaluation of the thing, the five-year development plan as is. You're not happy with it, all right? Too much cost to run. Or if you say, for instance, one of the things that that always bothered me, and I always talk to my wife, you know, saying all the time, as I'm so unhappy with it, is the Malaysian development plan is saying that you should have raised the income to what level, 14 something, you know, US dollars or something like that. I said that this is a very unhappy thing, see. So if there were many people like me who are unhappy with that, you know, they will say that, well, we got to really change this or do something with this kind of a target, which says that, well, the per capita income of the people and of everyone in Malaysia should be increased to 1400 US dollars and all that. Okay, we are not. So there are some people who might not. All right, and if they become sizable in number, then of course you will have to change the pattern. This is called simulation. Okay? You simulate the as-is world to the as-it-ought-to-be world. Okay? What do you want? For what? Why do you want to change it? Okay? Would you say that, well, I'm unhappy with 1400, I want 2000. So it's a higher value, right? But if you are happy with 14, unhappy with 1400, why would 2000 will be so much, you know, that you will be so happy with 2000? That's not meaningful, okay? Your target is well-being, you see. Well-being of the nation. This is more important, you see. John Rawls is a Harvard University philosopher. He has written less, not too much. But when he writes, the world listens, you see? And he has written a book in 1971. This book, from his Western point of view, okay, from his own Kantian Western point of view, is, the title of this book is A Theory of Justice, you see? In the theory of justice, he has two concepts, okay? Original points and difference principle, okay? Now, in the difference principle, what he says, that the yardstick of your development, okay, how much you have grown and developed and progressed, okay, is the yardstick of that, how many of the underprivileged people have you really improved? How much well-being have you given to the underprivileged people of your nation? You see, this is the yardstick. Okay? And on that very point, in 1989, later on, Amartya Sen writes on that recon, the beautiful, okay? The beautiful. This is the beautiful yardstick, you see. So the yardstick is not that, okay? I don't want to proceed on this kind of thing, but just to really mention to you, because I think it should be, you can share, at least. My wife and I, we went once to Digital Mall. It's a Digital Mall. And inside the Digital Mall, we formed a certain culture, okay, of who possesses capital. See? And we went out and we looked down, we walked in the street and we said, this is a culture. See, that is another culture. Who holds capital? Okay. This is the foundation of disparity. See, this is the foundation. This is where wage differentials arise. You see, human resource differentials arise. Okay. If you don't take that into consideration to make a development plan, I would not be happy, and many, many more like me will not be happy, and so we would like to have a society that ought to be on the basis of well-being. Okay. This is what is liberation. Okay. So in between the two processes, okay, you have process one, process two. Okay. In between the two, you have that improvable, okay, that which addresses important things of development, okay, and that's the most of this time. You disintegrate it, okay. So when you have that, so there were those who thought like that, okay. Then it never ends; it keeps on going. Hence, dialectical the learning process that they have. These are processes which have been dealt with Marx, with Popper, okay, and all these other people who talked about these kinds of dialectical processes. Okay. But the Quran says no. The world has been, the universe and everything in it has been made for a certain point in time. Okay, according to an appointed time. Okay, it will end. Okay, and hence the accumulated value of the universe. Okay, how valuable is your universe? If you were to take this whole universe and put it on a fulcrum, that is to say on a measure, right? And you ask the question, how what is the value, what is the measure, weight of this universe? According to this Tawhidi approach, what is the weight? What is the weight of this universe? See, the weight of the universe is that even in this scale, if you put the whole universe on one side, and on the other side you put kalima. See, you put the kalima, and you will find how much you have weighed according to the demands of the kalima. That is the shahada tawhid. See, the universe itself, everything that you take account of it inside it, the kalima has a higher weight. But how close have you come to value up to this? See, this is the valuation of the universe. You see, that is, you are permanently looking for well-being, stimulating it and progressing. And this progress is continuity. Okay? This is the sustainable nature of the universe. Okay? The universe is good. See? But you got to really measure up there so many things that you make and break. You give them weights. Okay. How well do you tally with the way the Tawhid is asking you to develop? See, this is the fulcrum, the balance. Okay. This is the mizan. Okay. This is the what we call the al-wasatiyah. See, the balance of things, the moderation, the balance of things. Okay. So you keep on going, and at the end of time, you say that, well, how well have you developed? How much have you developed? See, this is the point of reckoning. Okay, this is where you will be judged. Okay, and your not only individuals but nations, okay, will be judged. Okay, this is where the universe has accumulated knowledge. Okay, has learned itself in the midst of a target of achieving well-being, and has learned itself from process to process to process, going over time in this way, and there will come a time then where you will be asked, how well have you developed? What is the weight? That is the valuation of the universe that you have constructed. What is the weight of that? This is the day of reckoning. Okay, that is what is the great event. The great event, which is the Nabaul Azim, okay, as the Quran says, That is the great event. See, that is the event where the world will value itself. Okay, are you following? Okay, this is the ultimate target. Okay, all the rest are creative targets. Okay, of well-being, reaching it to this extent, to that extent, improving upon it, simulating it, and all that, and trying to attain a better level of well-being. Okay, until you come to that great event. See, this is the great event of the, what we call it, okay, judgment. All right, this is what is called. Therefore, when you say akhirah, when you say the hereafter, how do I interpret that in terms of a scientific terminology? The scientific terminology of the hereafter, that this is a closing event. See, it is a closure of the universe for the purposes of its valuation. Okay, and I have reached that point. Okay, that closure of the event, because of the fulcrum, the balance that you have to measure between Kalima and the world, the universe that you are evaluating. Okay, it's the akhirah. That is to say, it is the manifestation, that it is the expression of what is the final value of the universe. See, the final value of the universe, I don't know which universe we are talking about. It's everything that you can really talk about. See, its movement towards what? What is the valuation? And the valuation is how consciously have we accepted Tawhid. See, so the world moves from Tawhid to Tawhid. See, with the diversities inside. Okay, okay. It's a very beautiful sentence I read on Masudul, okay, who reverted to Islam a long time ago, of course, and he wrote his glorious Quran. Okay, and that in his introduction says, he says, Masudul Pictal says that the akhirah would not have been there if the world was not there. See, the world is a primacy, it's a reason for the akhirah. See, so this is the elegant equation which has got its very many different niceties, deconstruction, complexities, and all that kind of thing. Okay, it's a very huge field. See, I always tell myself that all the people don't like me for that. Is that I should write a book completely like that of the Principia de Mathematica, right? From the very beginning to the end, only mathematics to explain the Tawhidi universal system. See, and let's go on. See, we have been, yeah. It's a sorry thing to me. Okay, to say, to just at face value, to accept this statement. The statement that many of us is this, that the Quran is a book of guidance. Of guidance is hidayah, not a book of science. I don't agree with this one little bit. You see, the fact is why? You see, the fact is that if you want to study science, like right now we are doing, we are trying to in our silent mind, okay, in our mind's eye, we are trying to make a contrasting study of science as it is, and the science of, and Tawhid, and the Tawhidi science. See, already we are making that. See, so guidance is that. Guidance is not only on things that are, that, you know, on religious matters. See, guidance is very, very important on scientific matters. See, that is to say, which one will you choose in the marketplace? See, what kind of development will you choose? Okay. If you consider all of that within the light of Tawhid, then Tawhid is guiding as well as, alright, it is giving you choices. Okay, which one do you take? Which one you do not take? Okay, you reject. Hence therefore, the Quran is not, cannot be really said to be only a book of guidance in that sense, but rather it is a book of science from which you can raise science by means of the guidance of science. Okay, that you guide science, alright? So you are trying to argue on the nature structure of science by referring it to what the Quran says. Therefore, Quran has a much broader perspective of what is guidance, okay? Rather than simply limiting it to religious matters, right? So this is the approach I usually always take, okay? So, the unmeta science, okay? Well, let me just start when I'm talking about to you about this with an example. Okay. Okay. You say that there has come about in the world something which we call Islamic economics, Islamic finance, and things of that type. Okay. Now, if you say so, if you say that there is Islamic in something, then it must have the flavor of Islam in it. The moment they enter the door of that house, you know, which has that, okay, which is an Islamic house, I will feel that I'm entering a house that has got an Islamic flavor in it, okay, right? I will realize that, okay? So also when you're entering something called Islamic economics and finance, that Islamic economics and finance must give you the patterning, okay? Through that you must at once see in your eyes, in your mind's eyes, okay, that this is different, this has got certain things in it which is a guidance away from the usual way we do economics and science. Is this not guidance? Are there no ethics that we are guided, morality that we are guided on in constructing our models, our approaches, our behaviors on choice behaviors when we talk about Islamic economics and Islamic finance? There is. So thus therefore, even economics and finance, if you consider them to be science, okay, are guided in order to make them prescriptive of Islamic, this Islamic economics and finance. That's our great predicament, you see. We have failed in that, you see. The Muslim world has not gone into Tawhid, you see. It's failed in that thing. That when we enter today, the models, the arguments, the ideas, the conclusion, the everything of Islamic economics, there is nothing different, see? And this is what is necessary, alright? It is not late, okay? It is not late, see? But it is necessary, alright? Here, therefore, is the idea of matter science, okay? Likewise, okay? If you induce the universe, its explanation, if you call something which is matter beyond science as we understand it, okay, it must have its structure, it must have its consistency, its laws, right, its implications and formalism, okay, how you analyze the world according to that, you must have all of that, it must have continuity, and all of these things taken together will make the matter, the Tawhidi matter science, give Tawhidi matter science what it claims to be. Okay. That claim of the Tawhidi matter science is that it has got two profound properties which you recognize both as you march on in the evolutionary process of learning as well as at the end, every time there are some ends called small closures. Okay. I have learned over this process, esclosure and so on. So always is that kind of a, you have got to look at all of these things together to achieve that two major properties of the nature of matter, Tawhidi matter science. Okay? One of them is the Tawhidi matter science is unique. See? So there is the theorem of uniqueness. What does it mean? The uniqueness means that no other things copies it. Okay? It is all by itself there to give what we call a wonderful idea of what is the potentiality of the universe. What is my nature? What is the purpose of my existence? You see? Okay? This is what the Quran says. You see? Allah has not created the universe and everything in it just without a purpose. You see? It's a purpose. Okay? And the achievement, the actualization of that process, okay? So, I want to know the uniqueness, okay? This, and in the question of uniqueness is this. So, supposing you are doing economics, and you want to call it Islamic economics, and you want to go and say that a household as such, maximizes its utility. Okay? And you want to go and see and say that a producer, a firm, maximizes its profits. Alright? At the very moment, it is illogical. Okay? According to the Tawhidi worldview. See? The thing is that, see, if you are learning, okay, if you are perpetually, continuously learning, can you ever stop? Can you ever deny novelty? Okay? You can't deny novelty in a situation of perpetual learning. Are you following? If you are learning and learning and learning as an evolutionary phenomenon, you will never stop, will you? Okay? You will be thinking, you will be acting, you will be perceiving, okay? Your mind's eye will be brilliantly alive, all right? So, you will never stop. So, where is the optimum, okay? Okay? You cannot define optimum, no matter how you want to call it. Some people ask me, it's a small one, a small optimum, okay? There are, hodgepodge kind of things, you know, which are not tenable, okay? They are not tenable, see? Likewise, what is the nature of equilibrium, okay? Equilibrium, yes, you've got to integrate, but what kind of equilibrium is it? A nation, a Muslim nation, that integrates and sleeps and says that we have got reached the target. It's not really a dynamic Islamic nation, see? If you say the ijahada, the ishtihad, the shura, there is this kind of progressive ways of advancing forward and forward, onwards, all right? Then the equilibrium that you have is an evolutionary equilibrium, see? It has light around it. It is light, the light of knowledge, okay? And this light of knowledge will not let you sleep, see? So even the equilibrium that Allah is talking to you of in the Quran is of that nature. See, it's a perpetually learning, evolutionary learning equilibrium. Okay? And the inner things of that are deep and profound, as I said to you, and we'll have no time really to get into all of this kind of thing. Now, so you have therefore given it the shape and form. What is the shape and form? What is the primal thing that characterizes the legitimacy of the Tawhidi matter science? Okay. If you go to any economics, finance, sociology, psychology, politics, right? Even if you say biology, right? There's competing behavior in every one of them, see? We compete, see? Entities compete to attain a certain level of hegemony, that this is the way to think, right? It's a hegemony, okay? What is it in Islam when it's Tawhid? See? the Tawhid is saying that there is one thing which defines everything else. This is the primal ontology of Tawhid, the oneness of Allah, represented, explained scientifically in terms of the observation of His signs in the horizons, in you. Okay? According to what? According to the precept of unity of knowledge. You see, this is the simple one thing of the Tawhidi meta-science. Okay? All other meta-science have their own. If you go to economics, what is the foundational thing of economics? Okay? Rational behavior. You see? And rational behavior is endowed to human beings. Well, what about my grandchildren? Alright? The grandchildren shout and break and run about here and there. They are not expressing behavior. Very irrational, right? So, in society, we express a lot of irrational behavior. We make wrong choices. Okay? Okay? So, that's therefore the rationality assumption, which is foundational to economic reasoning, is a part and parcel of human behavior. See, does not take into account anything whatsoever about morality and ethics. There is no place for it. You see, there is no place for it. If there was a place, then they would give me an elbow. An elbow space to be accommodated. But there is no space for it. Okay? They are logical, but not real. You see, they are logical in the Tawhid. It's very logical. So here's another thing that I must ask. That's what, how I feel. Okay? That we have been told. And why am I saying all that? I'm saying all that because Allah has not bound your mind. You see? You have an attitude of inquiry. You see? Find yourself free to approach that other way with good intentions. You see? Good intention. We have been told many times that Quran should not be studied with logic. You see, I don't agree to that at all. Not a small bit. You see, because logic is just like, you know, do you want to eat rotten food or do you want to eat fresh food? Same food. You don't want to eat rotten food, you want to eat fresh fruit, food. So also it's logic. If you use logic for a wrong thing, coming over Aristotelian ideas, then of course, you know, I will agree with that. Because down the line, even if I use it, it will contradict. And when it contradicts, it will fall off. Alright? So logic itself is not an extradited thing. Okay? It's not an excluded thing. Okay? It is a matter of method. Okay? What method you choose in order to establish your arguments. Okay? So that's where you make abstractions and abstractions mean that when you go into building a house, you got to make a blueprint for the house. So also when you're making a market in science and biology, for instance, is also very tricky, right? Biology, right? Then of course you will have the Tawhidi blueprint, you see. Tawhidi blueprint. If you want to have dinar, right? If you want to have Islamic money, you got to have a blueprint. Okay? As to what will be the monetary functions, the monetary transmission, the monetary policies, and all those kinds of things will have to be thought about. Okay? These are the blueprints. Okay? So Tawhid also makes that. Make the mind active to make a blueprint of the thing that it wants to do at the middle point. Okay? So there, from there on, you have the progress. Okay? So sometimes you see, you don't be afraid, but you should be competitive. Definitely very competitive. You should know the world as it was, as it is, and what you think as it will be. Okay? These are very rich areas, you know, platforms of knowledge. Okay? But you should never be afraid of asking questions. Okay? Never be. If you are really doing science and analytics, abstraction, and many things, okay? don't be afraid, see. Okay, the one of the things that you say that should we always think as our mushtahids thought, you see. I don't want to throw them away. They are inclusive, not exclusive, but Allah has given us that kind of an open, inquiring mind to find out the truth. The truth, but nothing but the truth, okay? So in that pursuit, even if you have to, okay? What do you call that? You know, question some of the, okay? Fatwa, faith, and conclusions of the mushtahids, Allah will not drive you to the nar, okay? Not you. In fact, the Prophet said that dispute, you see, debates amongst the Ummah is a sign of blessing. Okay? So, the consciousness is important. Okay, let me go a little bit. And that's the world system that you study. Okay? As God is two things that I said to you. Okay? The world system that you study. Say, for instance, you have markets that you study in Islamic economics, right? And you have cosmologists, okay, theoretical physicists who study the heavens, okay? And when you study it within the light of Tawhid, I don't study what is Tawhid saying. These are not aqd, they are not aqd, see? They are not two different contracts, see? Like, for instance, in Islamic muamalat, okay, if you study Islamic financing, then mudaraba and, let's say, istisna and all this, they are not aqd, okay? They're not separate, isolated, separable pillars, no, okay? The Quranic model is complement, participate, join, interact with the diversities of the universe, you see? Connect rather than separate from one another, okay? So, this is what the generality, idea of generality is, you see? So when I am studying the Mu'amalat, I find in that the model, the abstraction, the formal models that I find in the Mu'amalat system, it exists in the heavens as well, okay? The cosmological model is no different on the general scale. They are only two particulars, okay? They are two separate entities of the universe, see? But one law governs them. I wish I could show you, let me come back to it, okay? So this is here. To read Surah Ra'd, okay? Surah Ra'd, and 13:1-5, see? And you can read that. Is Alif Lam Mim Ra. These are the verses of the book, and what has been revealed to you from your Lord is the truth. But most of you do not believe. It is Allah who erected the heavens without pillars that you can see. Then He established Himself above the throne and made subject to the sun and the moon, each running its course for a specified time. He arranges matters, He details the signs that you may, of the meeting of your Lord, be certified, certitude. And it is He who spread the earth. This is a system, see. This is one system He's talking to you about. The Quran is talking to you. And it is He who spread the earth and placed therein firmly set mountains and rivers, and from all of the fruits He made therein two winds. Okay. So of course, you know, you have to go deeper and analyze this by your own mind, free mind, and, you know, searching mind, as well as by investigating and finding out the tafsir given by many, many others on these matters. See? It is talking to you, this look, Allah has raised the heavens. This is a cosmological order. Allah has spread out the vegetations. This is the earth in between. And it is asking us, for instance, is there a gravitation that runs this whole course, or is it a law that Allah has placed? And the gravitation itself could be one of the laws, okay? But the law of gravitation itself is not universally applicable. We know very well what is the situation of the law of gravitation when the light rays come nearer to their body zone. Okay? It doesn't work. Okay? But nonetheless, okay, you've got to know it. So the Allah is saying in these verses of the Quran, think about the interconnectedness. Okay? You will not be able to interconnect unless you have the means to do that. And this means that enables you to interconnect is the universe law of Tawhid. The concept of universal is not a polemic. It's not just I'm a Muslim, that's why I say it's universal. Okay? That would not be the correct approach. It is universal because of its scientific nature of universality. Okay? And the scientific nature of universality is exactly being exemplified in this case. Okay? That the heavens and the earth are not separate entities in the sense of really understanding and bringing in the law of Allah's Tawhid. Okay? The Tawhidi law is one. Okay? It explains both of the systems, okay? The system of cosmology as well as the system of the world, of vegetation, of rivers and everything else, you know, in a pattern of complements, okay? In a pattern of universal similarity. Okay? So there is one law that governs all, but the all are in diversities. Okay? They live in diversity. And you've got to find out that from. Okay? That is the law of matter science. Okay? Now one of the things that how much time do we have? We have 1 hour. I will have to ask questions. So let me go on. Yeah, I think we'll have it. It's not here, not yet 11, it's 10:40. So we are trying. Okay. All right. Let me come down. So I have explained to you now so far that what you are trying to pursue in the construction of meta Tawhidi meta science is there a law? You're asking yourself as a searcher, as a researcher, okay? You're asking yourself, is there a law that would be unique to all systems of life? Okay. Is there a law that is that explains this phenomenon of the sameness? Okay? That it is the same law, okay? That Allah has given the same law to Musa and Ibrahim, right? Sufri Musa and Ibrahim, yeah. So, is it the same? Is there another law that can explain the universe in this integrated way, okay? Connected way? This is the unity of knowledge, see? So, when you're observing the universe, you observe that on the basis of what is that unity that you're talking about, okay? Now, we cannot connect the cosmology with the earth, with the earth, okay? With the world as it were. Cosmology with Mu'amala. We can't just put one with the other, all right? How do we really integrate them? How do we make these things in these different stages, okay, that the Quran is talking to you about? How do they make them interactive, okay, interconnected, bridged up, okay, not in upper, not in separate pillars, okay, which is a wrong conception, see? How do we do it is if we use the methodology of Tawhid to read oneness, that is unity of knowledge, as an organism. Okay. What is an organism? An organismic way of looking at the world, your lives and everything. It's a systemic way, systems way of doing. That is, that you are making, you are talking about as if you are making a very beautiful, very nice and tasty soup of the universe. All right? It's a soup that you take at home, all right? In which you have ingredients, all right? And you make it a wonderful soup of mixtures. Okay? So also is this. Okay? The Tawhidi Lord has enabled you to interrelate the cosmology, the heavens, the earth together. See? And this is the breaking down of Uqd. See? And Uqd is simply a legalistic convenience. See? Simply a legal form which enables you, gives you convenience that you will get your distribution according to a certain pattern of your holdings, okay? of your financial holdings. That is all. But nonetheless, if you play the principal agent's game, then you give the authority to the agent. And the agent will say, I will look after your well-being, right? And looking after the well-being means that I will make your capital investments in this kind of project, in this asset, flow in the direction where it is most useful. Okay? In the Islamic sense, the agent will be informed and will therefore not only look at your profit maximization, but it will look at the social well-being as well. Okay? So that's where he will drive my asset. So it's the same theory is with wakaf, all right? Why do you put money in wakaf? It's not an essential. It's not an essential if you don't buy wakaf in one form or another. You don't go anywhere. Allah is not very dissatisfied with you, right? But nonetheless, many Muslims buy wakaf, okay? It's out of conscious choice, okay? This is therefore, a wakaf is that kind of an asset, okay? Where an agent will put my money into that, although it's not a profitability. It's not, it is a social profitability asset, but not a personal profitability asset. My profitability comes from the blessings of Allah. All right? So that's where you are connecting the assets and the things together. It is this connectivity which makes us, our things, ourselves, animate and non-inanimate in everything in the universe participatory. Okay? So if that was not so, then the unity of knowledge will halt. Somewhere it will halt and won't progress. Okay? Will stop. Okay? But the entire model of the universe, see, is a learning, evolutionary learning model that interacts, meaning learns by connectivity. Integrates, attains a certain temporary equilibrium. Okay? These are evolutionary equilibriums. Now I'm going to take some examples here, okay, and say that, well, this is the nature of the game. If you are saying that Tawhid is a universal law that applies to quote unquote everything, okay? The word everything is a scientific word, right? If you read the book by Barrow on the theories of everything, okay? The theory, it's an Oxford or UP publication, okay? So it's a law, okay? That governs, that applies to, makes meaning by applying it to everything, okay? So it applies to biological thing, to phenomenon of the universe, of the cosmology, as well as to capital markets. Okay? It applies to everything. In what sense? In the sense of organisms. Okay? In the sense of interconnectivity. Okay? This is what the Quran is saying. Azwaja kullaha. See? So you are interconnecting the possibilities of the universe for attaining human and everything, everyone's, everything is well-being, okay? So you can see, what is the objective that we're talking about in all of these kinds of things? The objective, is it profit maximization? No. Is it steady state equilibrium? No. See? Is it some other form of maximization, which we call welfare economics, or production function, or economic growth. Is it any one of those? Okay. Or is it this? Or is it that? I want poverty alleviation. Okay. I want economic justice. Okay. No. See, we do not even go for economic justice. We don't go for social justice. We don't go for poverty alleviation. You see, we go for something else. See, something else is ibadah. See, is ibadah. You are made to recognize Allah's tawheed. We are made to recognize Allah's tawheed. That is what is my objective in life, right? But I will not be able to attain it if I don't relieve poverty, okay? If I do not give away zakat, right? If I'm not a conscious person who rules this world and arrogantly and think that I'm going to live here forever, see? So I am not anyone. I must keep those consciousness in mind to do ibadah, you see? I'm here, even to the extent that you have to have it. Clean environment. Okay? For instance, you know, yesterday I was complaining in the surau. The surau is stinking because it's stuffy, right? I said that no, you can't pray in an unclean environment. See, you have to open the windows, okay? And then of course it relieves itself. So you got to really be of that conscious. You're a conscious agent to do ibadah, right? But the objective is ibadah when you do well-being. So does it not tell you something? It tells you within, therefore, what is the well-being? What is its objective? The utility function has it explains something. It explains the level of satisfaction that I get by drinking tea and coffee. All right, or similar things. Okay. The production function has a meaning. It says that how much of optimal maximum output can a firm produce by utilizing its inputs of production, okay? Productive inputs. So there's a way of explaining all those kinds of things, okay? Which is fine and logical, okay? But what is the well-being telling you? The well-being is telling you that it is an objective function of the Tawhidi world methodological world, which tells you that you organize the world, consume the pleasures of this world, act in this world by generating interconnected organismic unity approach between different things of life, okay? Between different things of life, right? So, if you take an example, okay? You say that, well, runs by economic efficiency. Okay? It has to be a growing nation. It must have economic efficiency. But also it runs by distributive justice, okay? Poverty alleviation. So, what of that? But the budget is scarce. The budget is limited. Okay? So if the budget is limited, I can only hope to satisfy one against the other. To an extent, okay? So I cannot really give win-win situation to both, right? Tawhid would say no to that, see? There is as much scope to do justice to both of them, to economic efficiency as well as, even the efficiency idea is a very complicated one, efficiency as well as poverty alleviation, okay? How does that happen? Okay. So now the steeds of war of science will come in, the arguments will come in, formalism, the models that will come in, and will say, Allah has asked you to learn, and through the process of learning, you will choose continuously. Okay. So resources are things that are continuously produced, and one of the greatest resources is knowledge. Okay. I will know alternative ways of doing the same thing. Okay. I will know which is better than which is there, okay? Which is there. So I will know all that through the process of learning. Okay? And how will I learn?
I will learn only by interacting in the shape of connectivity, organistic, organic connectivity. So this is how I will always generate resources to make it available to things that otherwise, in other forms of economic arguments, they consider that to be competing things. Now in the Tawhidi world, because of that, that assumption, the axiom of learning being continuous, sustainable, okay? Because of that, resources are regenerated continuously. And the greatest resource is the learning resource. Okay? And this learning, evolutionary learning resource, will enable me to make both happy. Okay? So this is what is well-being. Well-being is that objective function which is talking to us. How well have you done in Ibadah? I ask, what is Ibadah? Ibadah means how well I have consciously, you see, understood the unity of knowledge as a participatory connection between different good things of life. Right? This is the measure that well-being gives me. And the well-being has to be evaluated. Okay? And this is a scientific, okay? This is a formal model kind of thing in which we said, how can you evaluate well-being? By itself, as I've just told you, well-being is a concept. See, it is not an empirical thing. But when you go into the evaluation of this well-being, then other things will come, which are part and parcel. You can't go outside this entire system and inject it in it. See, that is illogical, right? The thing should arise from the system, okay? So just like if you are doing a dissertation, okay, and at the end of your dissertation, you come with policies. Okay, you can't make policies without really addressing your dissertation. Your policies ought to arise from the dissertation. Okay, if they don't, then if they arise from the government's wishful thinking, then this is not logical. Okay, so also here, the entire well-being function is evaluated in numbers. Okay, it tells you what is the level of the value of the of your thing that you're doing, your thing that you're doing, your efforts. What is the value of this efforts in terms of the Tawhidi oneness, knowledge, unity of knowledge? Meaning here the inter-organismic interconnectivity between the good things, not as interconnectivity, but to evaluate that you have to go into other multiple other equations, okay, which I won't get into it today. Okay? They are called circular causation equation. None of these things really arise from your own wishful thinking of formalizing the model. Okay? That will not be correct. Okay? They arise from the Tawhidi unity of knowledge methodology and are brought into computer knowledge. Okay? And these are large system computer knowledge. Okay? I'm going to give you one or two, okay? Not by numbers though. Yeah.
Oh, that escaped this one. Well, I'll never have time.
Yeah, let me state this. You see, you have development. Development is necessary, development is good, okay? And you have sustainability, which is even better. Now, one of the ways that you look at development planning, okay, how do you plan your national development over 5-year period of time, okay, is to look at the health of the different sectors of your economy, okay? So if you say like this, you know, that we are industrializing, that a nation tells itself that we are in the progress, in the process of industrializing. So we are going to become an industrial nation in the year 2020 or 2030. But on the way, you are not really, a nation is not addressing its agricultural sector. See? So all of the industrialization is going on the backs of the manufacturing and similar kinds of industries. They're called the goods producing industries, right? And the agriculture is marginalized, okay? Now, according to the unity of knowledge, we have not attained the Tawhidi approach. Okay? The Tawhidi approach, in the same way as I said to you earlier, that there is a complementarity, not a substitution, not an akad between this and that. A complementarity between economic efficiency and social justice, etc. In the same way, the same thing applying to this development planning will tell us that the unity of knowledge, okay, is attained in development planning by establishing, constructing interconnectivities, okay, that is organismic relationship between goods producing industry and the primary industry. Okay, so what is the other way? We are saying that you develop your, like, if you want to get structural adjustment grant from the World Bank, then you have to follow the World Bank, okay? And then they will give you the grant. And the World Bank will use a neoclassical model, and it will say, develop your industry, and the trickle-down effect will come in and alleviate the poverty. All right? Doesn't happen, okay? In the long run, we are all dead, see? So, the Tawhid is saying, no, you got to connect, therefore, the industry that you do in the goods producing industry should produce ways and means of connection. One of that is institutional connection. Another one is revenue sharing. Okay? Another one is make up those kinds of projects, assets, you know, which will create good for both of them. Okay? Such, for instance, baby cereal food. Okay? How will you get cereal food if you marginalize the agricultural industry? See? So those kinds of things are necessary to interconnect. How will you interconnect? You see? You must therefore have a shura of the industry. You must sit down and think about ways and means of this developing these kinds of interconnectivities. These are organismic. Why organismic? Because they flow back and forth. Okay? They don't stay in one place. Okay? What is good for the goods producing industry is also good for the primary industry and vice versa. This is organismic, inter-causal flow things. How do you do it? You do it through those processes of participation, okay, of complementarities. See? What does that produce? See? It produces knowledge. Okay? And it is this knowledge that makes a technology. And that technology and that knowledge will make the way, will formulate the model. Okay? I'm not giving you the model, but this is the model, and one of the very, very beautiful, powerful models that you use in development planning of this type is called the input-output model. Okay, it's Leon Cieff's famous PhD dissertation, okay, on the basis of which he developed this idea. He got his Nobel Prize. Okay. It's this input-output coefficients model. If you follow the other way, you will get an input-output coefficient, but they will be static. They will be static. Okay? Static meaning that 10 years ago, you read something about this, there was a UNIDO made one input-output model, and therefore you're copying those kinds of coefficients from it. Or there is an input-output model for Scotland, all right? And you're taking this coefficient and you're bringing and fitting it inside yours in the hope that you will become a Scotland in the 2020. See? None of those, okay? It's a regenerated coefficient, okay? And therefore, each coefficient is induced, okay? Each of these coefficients is induced by knowledge, okay? And what you get at the end is a kind of a variable which is universally fitting, matching for all of the Tawhidi understanding. Okay? And let me show you that thing. Very simple though. Oh, yeah. Yes. Thus. As you go down in this, you will find this. That's the universality of X. aggression you take. See? So you are analyzing models of development planning where the idea is principally of interconnectivities, interflow, intercausal relationship between different sectors of the economy, so that in the process of development, you do not leave behind, don't exclude one and go with the others, right? You take the whole lock, stock and barrels together to create development, see? You don't leave the poor and make your way out with the rich, all right? You take all along the way, as the Arabs say, you know, go with the weak, not with the strong. They say, so this, that thing itself, you know, is that kind of an organic relationship of unity of knowledge, you see, comes out of the very essence of the weak. Okay? And thus the economy itself, it prospers by complementarities, togetherness. And the well-being of the economy. Now you could say that in my well-being function is growth. All right? Okay. The growth of what? GDP, gross domestic product of what? Of agriculture, primary industries. And then you have got goods producing industries. And the two together, meshed up together, is the GDP of the nation. Right, so you have a GDP which is generated by interconnectivity between these two things, and this interconnectivity is caused by the existence of knowledge, and this knowledge is the knowledge of how I can make this system unified, interconnected, intercausal, talking to each other, making us learn of the greater possibilities that lie beyond. See? So that is X theta. Now X can be universal in so many things, okay? X is not simply a variable, it is a vector, it is a mathematical matrix. I have even extended it to higher level multilinear algebras, it's called tensors. So it's many things, okay? It is price, all right? It is good. The price, the quantities, right? You can keep them away. The poverty alleviation, employment, the investments, whatnot. Okay? So X theta is a hybrid. It's many things together. All that we are really interested in knowing is how the well-being function is projecting the interrelationship, that is the bridging, interconnectivities between all of these different variables that get into X, say price, quantity, GDP, employment, etc., etc. Okay, so that is the way. Then, and when you do that kind of thing, then of course, okay, you have to really persevere. Okay, things don't come so simply in our lives, all right? We persevere for them. Okay, and the perseverance of this would be the models that you will develop in that way will not be simple models. Okay? They will not be linear models, which are so easy to be, you know, charted, right? They will be complex models. They will be non-linear models. You should be ready for it. Okay? But the whole system is computerized. See? It is a computer system. We have done all of this for the state of Oman. Okay? We did all that. Okay? So this is one. And the complexities that you have there is that whenever you have a relationship between two things or more things, right? And these kinds of models, they will minimally have three variables, minimally. Okay? So you have got coffee, tea, and then another variable. Okay, and that, if there are only three variables you're considering, then the two variables are coffee and tea, and the third variable is knowledge. See? And what does this knowledge do? That knowledge really integrates coffee and tea into a kind of an integrated industry, right? Or an integrated good, even. You never know. You're going to be drinking tea, coffee, after some time. And whenever you have this relationship, there's always a transition, a transformation. Okay. A relationship is a transformation. Okay. So if you say, I have a demand function, but the demand function has a quantity related to price. It's a relationship, right? But the quantity being related to price of the good must have a demand relationship to it, right? So all of these things are built whenever you talk about this interconnectivity, they have relations, okay? And these relations are transformable over and over again, okay? So as I said to you, you have one simulation and you want to simulate over simulate, then you have a simulation over simulation, you have a third simulation, and you can keep on doing this for many, many times according to the choices, the kind of patterns and paths that you want to choose. And this, you've got the last one that you can see the continuity of the functional ontologies. And these ontologies are not only the primal ontology, but these are ontologies of transformations. Okay? So a new product, a new technology, is caused by something which exists. Okay? So a new technology comes about. It's that kind of thing. In conclusion, I think we could stop for questions. It's 12 o'clock, right? We stop at 12, right? Yeah. But we can open up that to questions. Yeah. And finally, what we have here is. Yeah. Yeah, sometimes they might wonder. That in this kind of a system, the very first string that that's why I call it the TSR, that is the principal main driving string, okay? It's Tawhidi string relationship. It's string because it is interactive, it is evolutionary, it is integrated on the basis of one single primal ontology, which is Tawhidi, Omega. That is what gives the laws and causes the change. Okay? And we read that change. Okay? And in that system, everything, your development planning has become an ayat of Allah. See? Because you have consciously developed it according to the kind of patterns and the pattern that it should have in order to bring about well-being. You have really induced your consciousness inside that kind of a development model, okay? And that becomes the ayat of the Quran, right? For instance, money is already said in the Quran, it is an ayat. You see, nukud is an ayat of Allah. And you find that in Surah Al-Kahf, okay? So you find this kind of things, right? So here, therefore, is the case that this is the case, and as we march on and on and on till the end of time, or I sort of say, where of course the great event will automatically close up this learning process, right? The learning process ends, okay, with the same as the beginning. Okay, this is called a fixed point. It's a very important fixed point theorem, okay, in mathematics. Called a fixed point theorem. If you just don't have one closure, if you don't have two closures, you will never find an equilibrium in sight. See? The equilibrium will drift away into something else. Okay? So, if that is the case, then let's say you are towards the end. Okay? And let us say that people have entered heaven. Alright? They have accomplished. They are successful. They have entered heaven. Then what is the meaning of x theta? Would that mean that theta would have blown to such an extent that x is carried with it and you will see mountains, an apple becoming a mountain? Nothing like that. Okay? Because you experience in life that the worth of a thing is in its quality. You see? The quality will become very refined, okay? So the theta will really become so refined, closer and closer to Tawhid, because theta is derived from the law of Tawhid. So it will get so much ikhlas, you know, so much purity in it, that the things that it will induce, like for instance, you know, many in the Quran also you have this kind of thing. Oh, we have seen this in the earth, okay? Dates, for instance, right? Same that people are saying who have entered heaven, oh, we have seen this in earth, all right? So these are the kind of things. They don't attain magnitude. They attain the depth of quality, you see? So theta blossoming itself to that kind of a high level of class of purity in it also carries with it the purity of is an example of Kausar, you see? Kausar is that, you see? It's the canal of rhythm of milk, right? But it's not the milk that we drink, you see? It has achieved its ikhlas in such a way that it has carried the things that it induces to that extent, you see? So there is nothing that I stand to correction, because after all, it's only a human endeavor to explicate, to bring forth the idea of the meta-science. This is one of the things is this, that in science, okay, we talk about great strides in technology, great discoveries and all that, right? Let's see the logic. You say that, well, the universe is unbounded and open. Okay? So the universe is unbounded and open in two ways. Okay? If you take the usual scientific meaning of this unbounded and open universe, then there are certain materials in the certain domains, okay, certain spaces in the universe which they call dark matter. Okay? Dark matter is that here the law of gravity doesn't exist anymore. Okay? So the universe is liable to expand, okay, in an inflationary way across those regions. Okay? It can. This is one of the things that they attach to that kind of a bounded, unbounded, and open universe. Okay? Now, the idea given by Tawhid of the unbounded and open universe is this. The universe expands, grows itself through a multidimensional frame. Okay? Whereas in the other science, the universe grows through two-dimensional frame. Okay? The two-dimensional frame is of space and time. Okay? Space and time. Whereas in the Tawhidi frame is knowledge, space, and time. Why is knowledge required? Because without putting that knowledge, we will not learn, and hence our choices in the universe, our models, our abstractions, our experiments, and our application will all remain, okay, subdued in a humanly developed understanding of what he wants to be, what he wants the universe to be. Okay? So it is a kind of a self, and what we call this, it's a and anthropomorphic, okay? Anthropomorphic is human choice, okay? Doesn't, if you think like that, what is the Tawhidi world telling you, okay? Tawhidi world is telling you that every choice you make, you see, it is induced, okay? It is induced either by consciousness or by differentiation, by the lack of consciousness, okay? For instance, riba and trade. Okay? Trade, the choice of trade is consciousness, and the choice of riba, you can do it. I was trying yesterday to find out some data for any country. Went and searched for many countries. What's happening to the trend between river and yields, or savings, bank savings, river and yields? I could never find anyone justifying the Quranic ayat. See, what does it mean? Quranic ayat is not incorrect. It means that we are just reading statistical figures. See? And the statistical figures don't have any way of explaining the interrelationships. Okay? That if you have a river opposing trade, then how many people you will kill? See? How many poor people you will leave behind? See? So there are many things that are relational in nature. We do not read them when we just go, you know, pop our eyes open and find our strength. Trends don't speak of relationships. Are you following? Okay. So here too, we have to have theta as a must to choose x theta and over time, d theta, over time. Okay. Now in that case, therefore, if we say the following, that the process that we went through, the end is omega, right? The beginning is omega. The middle is the world system, the learning world system. So that omega at the beginning is supercardinal, see. It is non-configurative, right? It is full of knowledge. It is glistening with knowledge, all right? So it's the end. Okay? In the end, the only experience is nadira and basira. You see it, you experience it, okay? So the world has attained itself, see? If I say a good story to you, but there is no matching thing outside there, then your grandchildren will say, where is that tree? I want to see that tree. Right? You can't show the tree, you just told him a story. So there you are, you see. It's a proof of the beginning, which is realized itself and shown to you. You see? It's the proof. Okay? So the Jannah and Nar, all the things are proofs of that completion. This is not the closure. But the closure is of the same nature as the beginning. Okay? So omega is all the same. That omega at the end is unbounded and open. Alright? It's unbounded and open. So if science is saying we have closed the universe, okay, up to the time of materiality. This is where the material things end, okay? Materiality, and we have examined the universe in the range of materiality. Then the question is, how does science answer the question of the non-physical, okay? The non-physical universe, okay? Which is beyond, this is meta-science, see? Meta-science. Many of the models that you will find between Tawhidi, that arise from Tawhidi understanding and the science of today, is like this. Even if you see that if you cut this up, you cut omega and you cut omega, see? And if you read, for instance, the Model of Social Becoming, okay, by Petrus Stonka, and another one by Leslie Ken Bull on knowledge in Marxism. They are the same. There's no difference. The methodology, the methods, and all of these things are procedurally the same, but substantially they are different. See? Substantially they are two different universes you're talking about. But procedurally, that you talk about the same kinds of explanations and all those kind of things, particularly in the area of what we call the dialectical processes. So that thing remains an open question. What happened in this universe? Okay? What happens in that universe? Okay? That is a question unanswered, okay, by all of sciences. Okay? It does not mean that science does not try to do ibadah. It doesn't mean that. Okay? Because of the fact that many good people, they want to do people good. Okay? And they are scientists. Okay? But the idea of all of that thing is that they, those two things are missing. And because of that, that you have the meta science of Tawhid quite different in its power on the multi dimensions of knowledge, space that is induced by knowledge, time that is induced by knowledge, as opposed to science as we study it, which is really a specialization within space time structure. This is the domain of the usual science, and you can encapsulate in it all things. Okay? So Tawhidi law at the end is not simply doesn't give you a methodology that is only good for economics and finance. It's a universal methodology of systemic, an idea of systemic views. Just before I just end up, you know, I would not do. This is good. This is the single system, TSR. Single system is like that. Single system in that you are just talking about finance, okay? And as opposed to the multi-system thing, as you're not talking only of finance, or better still will be like this. Because we have written a paper in this area, an accepted paper. Is what we're talking about Sharia. Which is of a legal nature. And then we talk about economics. And the single system, TSR, means to apply all the ideas, the methodology, the application, and inferences, applying after having used this methodology of Tawhid to one of the systems, not considering two together. So you have a Sharia. So there you will talk about the development of Sharia instruments, okay? The legitimacy of Sharia instruments. Okay? As opposed then you will talk another system, which is the system economics. And economics will talk to you about many of the indicators, measurements, performance indicators that you find being spoken for economics. Okay? As opposed that is one way. Which again throws the two into buckets, okay, without really understanding the interconnectivity. And then you have the multi-dimensional TSR. Okay. In the multi-dimensional TSR, you have the same, the Sharia and economics, okay, but then you have got interconnection. So you are talking about two domains which are interconnected with each other. The same model, the same methodology of Tawhid, of unity of knowledge applies. It takes up a little bit more complexity, but the idea is the same. Okay? But now your idea is not right, the same. It is interconnected in complementary idea between the two phases. Okay? So I think I'll just stop here and then ask you questions, and if you have any questions to ask. Thank you. Questions? Really? Did you all understand what I said in a nutshell? Right? Yes.
Please. Actually, I'm interested with the point that you mentioned, Islamic finance, in the akad that you mentioned. There is a misconception, akad, mudharabah, ijarah, or many akad that involve Islamic finance. But how we can translate the concept of Tawhidi and how we can see the interaction, the concept of Tawhidi, the theory of goodness, in the Mu'amalat of Islamic finance, especially with the akad.
Yes.
How we can fight between parties, which is bankers, borrowers, legal, with the akad.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. Well, let me take two approaches to your question. You'll be answering in two ways. One is the theoretical approach, okay? The theoretical approach is that if you are aware of Tawhid, if you spring from the springboard of consciousness. So what is consciousness in something like a beautiful word. So if you assume that you have this consciousness with you, then you will know that what is Tawhid telling me about in my constructions. See? So you take Mudharabah and you take Ijab. See? Now you know that you have a connectivity between the two because they are both good things, okay, to finance a project. But what is lacking today is the interconnectivity between the two. See? So what does that mean? It means that Mudharabah will not survive if it is allowed to go by itself. Right? It has to depend on Ijara. Okay? Ijara will not survive ultimately if Mudharabah doesn't come to its help. Both Mudharabah and Ijara must both survive. Okay? So they must both win-win, okay, to stay in the financial market. Okay, this needs an interconnectivity. See? How does that interconnectivity occur? Being a conscious person, starting from that initial point of view, you would say, well, let's make a portfolio. Okay, a portfolio that has Mudharabah and Sharp. In that case, the banker trying to do. He's trying to save the portfolio. He's trying to protect the portfolio comprising Mudharabah and Ijara. He's not interested in one or the other thing, okay? Only on Ijara or in Mudharabah, see? So he said that if this is going to be so, then I'll be interconnected, see? And how does that interconnection happen? It happens by Ijara winning, getting, you know, and then financing Mudharabah. See? So Mudharabah does not lose all its financing, okay, which is what's happening now. Okay? And just this is the idea of Ijara growing but protecting in order to keep the integration between the two. This is the well-being concept of unity. And it is represented in the portfolio. And the portfolio has a objective, and this objective is to keep the two surviving, okay, by this process of interconnection. That is done by a function called well-being. Okay? So this is when you are a conscious person trying to do that kind of thing, okay? And you win maybe the Nobel Prize one day. But the other thing is, the banker is not at all knowing about Tawhidi beginnings and all that. Okay? He suddenly comes into the field and he wants to do good. See? So he wants to take these two others. Okay? Then what happens? Okay? If he's not coming into the field with an assumption, with pre-knowledge of all this thing, what are the religious teacher? Then you become a third participant between the client, the one who invests, the bank, and you. You see, you teach, okay? Therefore, what it means is that an Islamic bank is not only a commercial enterprise, you see? it is a human resource development enterprise as much as it is also it is a I was once watching a BBC documentary, right? It was a BBC documentary on the future of business, see? And there were business people there, along with the BBC staff, and many very prominent students who were carried from all around the world, okay? What will be the future of business, you see? So this is what it is, the sensitivity of teaching. Okay? For instance, if you say that, well, there are certain stuff, okay, that an enterprise in Malaysia should not really buy, although it is halal, right? For instance, why would you buy crab cheese from Australia when you can make your cheese? You see the point? Or if you can trade better on cheese with another Ummah partner, okay, why would you create a leakage? Okay? So those are things that come from the corresponding, that's to say the table talk. Someone is teaching. Okay? This is where that what we call is induction. Okay? Knowledge induces, okay? Change. So that is what the how the two approaches can be done. See, am I answering? Yeah. Other questions? Yeah.
It's okay. Normally, the investors in Islamic bank, they know that there is a risk of loss, but they don't want to take the risk. For example, nowadays we see in Islam Bank they have two types of investment. One is the capital should remain same and you will get profit. Another one, your capital may reduce because business can get loss also. So how the Islamic banks will overcome this risk of investment?
What are the two problems? One is capital?
It's two types. In Islamic Bank, for investment there are two options. One, your capital remain the same, then you will get
okay.
Profit.
Yeah.
You won't get less. The capital should not get less. Another one, you may gain or you may get lost.
Yeah.
How to overcome it? The investors, they don't want to take the risk, but the Islamic bank, they want to follow the Sharia properly.
Mm-hmm.
Any comments, please?
Yeah. On this two options. See, your capital is remaining fixed, and the other one is capital is variable. Okay? And you choose the returns that a variable capital raises. Okay. If I answer that from a Sharia point of view, okay, that even the capital is subjected to risk and return. Okay, so a bank that keeps the capital fixed, see, it loses some of the relationship that it should have with risk and return. See, so whether this is really a tenable in a Sharia point of view, it's questionable, right? It's questionable because, as you know, if you study the theory of the firm, for instance, see. In the theory of the firm, whatever you produce, see, you have got two kinds of production functions, see. One of the production function is short run, and the other is long run, okay? Now, in the short run, you value labor, but you keep capital fixed. So it's not what we call non-malleable. It's not like your earth, you know, you can make a putty clay with it. See, it's not like fixed. Okay? And on the basis of this fixed, you employ labor, you fire labor, whatever. It's also in investments. It's also important. If you are going to generate investments on the basis of capital, flexible and capital, okay? So the capital that is flexible will bear all that kind of risk to generate investments. Okay? And the capital that is fixed doesn't change its spot. It remains fixed itself. So it's not very, you cannot make it into shapes, right? I don't think that my understanding is that such a kind of an enterprise is not Sharia way of looking at business. Not the, I may be
not following the Sharia
correction. Any other?